Praise the Lord, church. Praise the Lord again. Happy New Year. I'd warned you, I was going to say Happy New Year until February. I'm just trying to keep to what I said. It gives me so much joy to be bringing to you God's word today. I remember last week we talked about work. Remember that? We looked at the example of Abraham, how Abraham diligently undertook that hospitality job that came his way. And there was so much to glean from that. And we challenged ourselves that whatever we do, that first, we do it for the glory of God. Remember that? We said the second thing, whatever we do it how? We do it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's where our strength comes from. And then we said, whatever we do, let us do it with all our heart as we are doing it for the Lord and not for our human masters. Whatever we do. In other words, what we were trying to say last week is that your work matters, in case you missed it. So I wonder whether you approached your week with that attitude. Did you sort of apply yourself differently this week? Huh? Well, I want to encourage you, don't give up, okay? Maybe you're looking at me and you're like, Pasi, I wish you understood my work situation, okay? I agree with the things that you said. It's just that I feel like they cannot be applied in my life. And maybe that is true. There is a lot that was not said in this sermon. I remember when we met in our real group, you know, we were going through, you know, certain scenarios. And I'm hoping that you guys can continue to have those conversations there, you know. What if they take advantage of me and blah, 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 blah. So how do you respond in such cases? You know, that's why real groups are there. But as for us generally, I just wanted us to remember that how we go about our work, which is the place that we spend the most time, matters. For many of us, that is really where we get to shine for the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So this week we move on to something else. And what we want to say is that your prayer matters. Okay, so last week was your work matters. Today is your prayer matter. In fact, this coming week, as Pastor Kadu said, we're going to go to a season of prayer and fasting. And we want to pray for, let me say that again. This coming week, we're going to go into a season of prayer and fasting. Amen. Thank you. That's, I knew you were going to say that because you're looking forward to it. We're going to be asking the Lord's will to be done in our lives, in our families, in our church, you know, in our places of work, in our country. We want to stand in the gap. And if you know anything about prayer and fasting, then you know it is hard work. It's hard work. Somebody rightly said that prayer is not preparation for the great work. It is what? It is the great work itself. Little wonder, some people, when they hear that we are going to go into a season of prayer and fasting, they wonder, why do people do these kind of things to themselves? Indeed, as Kadu said, you know, many of us fasted in January because of circumstances. And you're like, surely I cannot do it again. Well, friends, our praying matters. We do it because it matters. And when we fast, we are reminded to pray. And so, allow me to say some things that Kadu didn't say. We do have a prayer manual. You can find it on our website. And I think the real groups are also sharing this around. If your real group leader hasn't sent to you, please ask them. And then, Pastor Eric, who leads our prayer ministry, there, he's lifting up his hand. He's telling me, we will be meeting on Zoom every morning from 6 to 6:30 a.m., okay? 30 minutes early in the morning to just begin our day together in prayer. So if you have the time, please let's meet up together and begin to pray together. So you can find this link also on our website. And then that Friday is when we are closing our fast. We'll be coming here Friday in the evening from 5:30 to 7, have a time of singing, worship, praying, and then we'll break our fast. Amen? So to develop this idea that prayer really matters, I want us to go back to the story that we were looking at in Genesis chapter 18 and sort of continue from where we left. So if you can turn there with me. I'm sure you guys had already marked it from last week. And you're there. Genesis 18, where we left off in verse 8. Abraham had just brought that feast fit for a king, you know, and given these three men who had visited him. And then he was standing right next to them as they were eating, right? That's where we left off last time. So verse 9 to verse 15, I'll just summarize it, okay? What happened is the Lord and the angels, these three, they confirmed the promise that God had given to Abraham before, that he was going to have a son through Sarah. So they said, we will come back next year at a time like this, and you will have a child. So they just confirmed that promise. Sarah was somewhere not far in another tent, and she overheard all this conversation, and she began to laugh, you know, and she was saying to herself, probably, yeah, you guys got jokes. In case you do not understand, you missed the bus. Okay, that's what under the bridge, you know, she was laughing. What are you talking about? In my age, at 90 years, my husband, 100 years old, this is the time we're going to have be starting having children. Wow. She was kind of laughing at this idea. Which the Lord turned to Abraham and said, why did Sarah laugh? Why did she say, am I going to have a child now? Is there anything too hard for God? You know, and later on, Sarah would step out and say, Aki, I did not laugh. me, laugh. You know, of which the angel said, the Lord said, no, you actually laughed. And their child was going to be called later Isaac, which means laughter. Okay, interesting. Verse 16. I want us to read together. It says, when the men got up to leave, they looked down towards Sodom, and Abraham walked along with them to see them on their way. Okay, being the good host that he is, he feeds them, and then he escorts them when it's time to go. Then the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do? Abraham will surely become a great and a powerful nation, and all nations of the earth will be blessed through him. For I have chosen him so that he will direct his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing what is right and just, so that the Lord will bring about for Abraham what he has promised him. It's what I call privilege. Abraham was privileged. I mean, this is the Almighty God who is saying, shall I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do? And Abraham is called the friend of God. In fact, he's the first person who was called the friend of God. Because he is God's friend, God says, I can't hide stuff from him. I'll tell him what I'm thinking, what I'm about to do. I think that's a privilege. That's a great honor. Wouldn't you not like that? So what the scripture says in Psalms chapter 25, verse 14, it says, the Lord confides in those who fear him. He does that. In fact, thinking about that theme verse in the book of Proverbs, which says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, I wondered, could it be we become wise when we fear God because the Lord does confide in us and he reveals things to us and thereby making us wise? Well, this is also the life of the Christian, because this is what Jesus Christ said in John chapter 15, verse 15. He said, you know, I do not call you guys servants, because the servants do not know their master's business. I'm calling you guys my friends. Why? Because everything that I have learned from the Father, I have revealed to you. Christian, what a great privilege, what a great honor that we have. The Lord is revealing to us all things. So Abraham was privileged. Yes, the Lord is confiding in him. He has the promises of God. God is saying he's going to become great. He's going to become a great nation. All the people of the world will be blessed through him. I was thinking about him, if he was a Mamlakite, it would have been said, you know, and he will impact the nations for Christ. I've called him that he may raise his family in a certain way, right? To teach his children righteousness and justice. So I'm going to confide in this man. What a great privilege. What a great honor. It says like this in verse 20. He says, then the Lord said, the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is so great and their sin is so grievous that I will go down and see if what they have done is as bad as the outcry that has reached me. If not, I will know. Okay, so God finally answers himself and he decides, I'm going to confide. And he tells Abraham, the outcry against Sodom is so huge. But I ask myself, okay, this outcry, where did it come from? I wonder whether you ask yourself that question. Who is this who is doing the crying? Could it be perhaps Lot? Because we're told that Lot was staying in Sodom. In fact, this is what Peter says in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 7 to 9. He says that Lot was distressed and tormented in his righteous soul because of the wickedness in Sodom. And maybe he was the guy who was like, God, Aki, this place is messed up. Maybe he was the one who was crying out. Or it could also be, maybe the outcry reached God from the people who experienced the hostility and the violence that was really in Sodom. We'll see in the next chapter. Well, not next Sunday, but if you were to read yourself, you will see just what kind of people were in Sodom. I mean, it reads like some horror movie. The kind of atrocities they come to do to these men who went there, these angelic men. They want to sodomize, they want to rape. Like, what kind of people are this? And could it be this is the kind of thing they used to do to people? Maybe visitors, strangers, as they pass through that area, they would do these kind of beastly things to them, and they would cry out to God. And here God is saying, you have actually been hearing these cries. And I couldn't help but understand, friends, that God does hear the cries of injustice. He does hear the cries that rise up to him of those people who are being victimized, who are being abused. These cries do rise up to God. He never turns a deaf ear to them. And I know this is relevant because in our country right now, those have been the talking points. So much violence that has been going around. You guys have been seeing those things. I don't know, femicide and stuff like that. I want you to know that all these cries, they go up to God. He hears. The outcry has come to me. And here God steps in to act. I wonder though, what does he mean? You know, I'll go and see if they're as bad as the outcry. If not, I will know. It's like, God, don't you already know all things? You know that God knows all things. Earlier on, he already told Sarah when he was trying to lie, Aki God, me, I have not laughed. I was like, you laughed. He knows these things. He knows everything. God doesn't need to learn. But this has been written in a human sort of language. It is just a way of showing that God is never quick to pass judgment. He is very thorough in how he goes about these things. He is giving this Sodom another chance. He says, I will go there myself. It's just a way of giving them another chance. I find that this is what Jonah himself discovered. Remember when God came up to Jonah and told him, Jonah, I want you to go and preach against Nineveh because their wickedness has come before me. Just the very same thing. And Jonah took off and ran. Later on in chapter 4, when Jonah was giving a reason why he ran, he says, God, I knew it. I knew this was what you were going to do. You're a God who is slow to anger. You're abounding in mercy and tender loving kindness. You're a God who relents from sending calamity. Maybe this is what God was trying to communicate. I'm not rushed. Sending judgment. Those of you who think that God is so hostile, I want you to know that, in fact, the opposite is true. God is very patient. Verse 22. The men turned away and went towards Sodom. But Abraham remained standing before the Lord. Then Abraham approached him and said, will you sweep away the righteous with the wicked? What if there are 50 righteous people in the city? Will you really sweep it away and not spare the place for the sake of the 50 righteous people in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to kill the righteous with the wicked, treating the righteous and the wicked alike. Far be it from you. Will not the judge of all the earth do right? Verse 26, the Lord said, if I find 50 righteous people in the city of Sodom, I will spare the whole place for their sake. Wow. We're going to come back to some of these things. Verse 27, Abraham spoke up again Now that I have been so bold as to speak to the Lord, though I am nothing but dust and ashes, what if the number of the righteous is 5 less than 50? Will you destroy the whole city for lack of 5 people? If I find 45 there, he said, I will not destroy it. Once again, he spoke to him, what if there are only 40? What if only 40 are found there? He said, for the sake of 40, I will not do it. Then he said, may the Lord not be angry, but let me seek, what if only 30 can be found there? You know, he's really pushing it. In fact, I feel like he's growing a bit bold. Okay, he was reducing it by 5s. Now he's trying 10s. Okay. He answered, I will not do it if I find 30 there. Abraham said, now that I have been so bold as to speak to the Lord, what if only 20 can be found there? He said, okay, for the sake of 20, I will not destroy it. Then he said, may the Lord not be angry. Let me speak just once more. What if only 10 can be found there? He answered, for the sake of 10, I will not destroy it. I'm just keeping it simple. Just answering the man. When the Lord had finished speaking with Abraham, he left, and Abraham returned home. Wow. Friends, your prayer matters. Your prayer matters. God was willing to respond and make adjustments with every petition that Abraham gave. Did you see that? In fact, I wonder, why didn't Abraham go all the way to 1 or 0? Why did he stop, right? I don't think God even told him what the limit is. I was thinking about this. I was like, look, I know God knew where Abraham was going. Why didn't God not just cut into the chase and say, Abraham, hey, hold up, when he was like at 45, hold up. 10, that's my minimum, okay? Take it or leave it. You know, this whole story would have been made a little bit shorter. No, but we're just treated to this whole idea of Abraham coming and asking the Lord. And then the Lord says, sawa, for that I will do it. And then he goes and then he comes back again, you know, makes adjustments like that patiently. It's like the Lord doesn't mind this. He adjusts as he's being asked. And I was like, friend, such is the mystery and the power and the privilege of prayer. Mystery because we know that God knows all things, right? And God can do all things. And yet he still asks us to pray. Like, okay, God, you can do all things. God, you know all things. Why don't you just do what is right? Why do we need to pray? It's a mystery. And commentators have talked about this, and there is ongoing debate as to who prayers really are for. Are they really for God or for ourselves? Whose mind is really changed when we pray? Is God's mind the one that is changed, or is it just our mind? In fact, they said in this situation, maybe it is Abraham's mind that was changed. What Abraham just needed to know is that God will do what is right. And once Abraham was convinced of that, he was happy to go. Maybe. The debate still rages on. God asks us to pray, though he knows all things, and though he has power to do all things. And prayer is powerful. Friends, think about it. The Almighty has decided to allow us to partner with him in what he's doing around the world. That you and I can participate in the divine plan through our petitions, our prayer, our intercessions. That we have an opportunity to contribute to what God is doing through our prayers. Does this move you? Do you recognize just what a privilege and a great honor this is? I remember that lamentable verse that is in the book of Ezekiel, Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 30. God says, you know, I looked for someone among them who will build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land so that I would not have to destroy it, but I found no one. So I will pour out my wrath on them and consume them with my fiery anger, bringing down on their own heads all that they have done, declares the sovereign Lord. I was like, what? There was no one found who could do what Abraham was doing to Sodom. He says, I was looking. It's like, what is this thing called prayer? It matters so much for God. It somehow has a weight in God's economy. Listen to what Paul says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. So what Paul says, he says, I urge then, and urging, you know, is really persuading strongly. So he's persuading us very strongly. He says, I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. I was like, Yanni, you mean to tell me there is a connection between our prayers and intercession and our shalom, shalom? We're talking about shalom, shalom the other day. So it's like, do you want to lead peaceful and quiet lives? Lives that are biladrama? Okay? He says, be praying. And I wonder whether your life has some drama. Maybe shalom, shalom, that we were talking about the other day, you are like, Lord, if you actually give me that. Ask yourself this question. Could it be, how's your prayer life? Have you been praying for this country? Have you been praying for your family? Have you been praying for God's people? It says that there is a connection there. It's what James says in James chapter 5, verse 16. He says that the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Prayers are powerful and effective. In fact, I was thinking that prayerlessness is really Satan's biggest victory in assaulting the church. That you and I struggle to pray. Oh, what a victory. Satan has outdone us there. Because there's so much power. Prayer saves nations. You know, God would say in 2 Chronicles chapter 14, verse 7, you know, if my people who are called by my name, you know, would humble themselves and would pray, would turn away from their wicked way, would seek my face, I would hear from heaven, I would forgive their sins, and I would do what? I would heal their land. Prayer saves nations, people, lives. When we pray, things happen. But it's the thing that we struggle with the most. Friends, I'm trying to make much of the privilege and the power of prayer. And I'm so glad that Abraham knew this. And so he pushed hard with his intercessory prayers as he was standing in the gap for Sodom. And I want you, friends, to know that our praying matters. Our intercession for our families, our friends, our country, our other nations, it matters. And I'm hoping that we will join Abraham in doing this thing, pursuing God, praying, asking. In fact, I want to share five things that I saw from how Abraham went about it, you know, this his prayer that we can apply in our lives, okay? I tried to put them all starting with the letter R, okay? This is not so perfect. You'll forgive me where it looks like I, okay? It was so that you can remember. Here's the first one. He remained alone. Okay? I was trying to make a case for just spending time alone with God. You remember when they were there, Abraham was seeing them off. There were three of them. Then I don't know whether Abraham knew the two were angels, one of them. I do not know. But all I know is that after the fellowship was over, after they had said the grace and people had started to leave him, he lingered kidogo with the Lord. You saw that? And he began talking to the Lord. I'm trying to make a case for finding time alone with God. I know that there are some people who are easy with God whenever they are around others. In the company of other people, they're easy with God, okay? In church, yeah, they can pray in church. They can pray in real group. They can pray in Friday prayers. You know, I remember there's a time when I really, you know, rebuked myself. When I was in church, I was praying such powerful prayers. Hey, and I called myself for a meeting. I was like, how come in church you're praying such powerful prayers, but privately your prayers are so dry and you're struggling so much? And I said, look, my prayers in private, ought to be fervent and powerful as well. If I'm really a friend of God, it is possible. You're easy with God whenever you're in the company of others. I wonder whether you have ever been in that awkward situation, you know, where you find yourself in a room with somebody who, whenever you know how to relate with them whenever you're in the company of others. But just when there's the two of you, yeah. So here you are, you arrive early in a meeting, you know, other people are supposed to be in that meeting, you know, them, they arrive first, and then you. Okay, and then you find yourself, you're the two of you, you know, in a room. And let's just say those minutes that you wait for other people, maybe 10 minutes, are the longest 10 minutes in your life. You try weather talk, it's not connecting. You try silence, it's even worse. And the best thing you have to do is excuse yourself. You need to go to the washroom. But what you want to do is go and call the other guys away. Mko. Because you cannot interact with this person by yourself. Friends, let that not be you and God. Make time to be with God alone. Let God be your friend. In fact, I said to myself, if you pray better when you are with God and others than you do privately, maybe you need to ask yourself, am I really God's friend? Find time to be alone with God, to talk about stuff. Amen? And of course, also find time to be with God with other people. So he remained alone. That's the first thing. The second thing, he had reflected on the character of God. And this is how I wrote it for myself. I wrote, reflect on God's word. Because I believe that in God's word, that's where God reveals his character. That's where God's self-revelation is in his word. So understand God's word. Because this is what we see Abraham doing. Abraham presented God with a dilemma. God, are you going to treat the righteous and the wicked alike? You see that in verse 23? It's like Abraham was convinced that God, in his justice, because of something that he knew about God, could not treat the righteous and the wicked alike, that he would distinguish the two. It's like Abraham was holding God to his word. He was holding God to his character. He was holding God to his justice. He was holding God to his promises. He was holding God to his character. I don't know. He understood something about God. And that's why he would say again and again, in fact, he would say two times, far be it from you, God, to do this. Far be it from you, God, to do this. Why? Because he understands the character of God. So these are the things that he's taking before God. God, you're like this. You can't do this. I find that if you know little about God or God's word, you have really nothing to tell God. Your prayers become very shallow because you're very ignorant. But you are blessed if you know the promises of God, if you understand his covenants, if you understand his character and the things that he has said about himself. These are the things that you take before him in prayer. And it makes for very powerful prayers. Because the Lord will not go against his word. Amen? So reflect on God's word. Understand the character of God. Give yourself to understanding the scriptures. Here is the third one. I call it reverence. In verse 27, it says, then Abraham spoke up again, now that I have been so bold as to speak to the Lord, though I am nothing but dust and ashes. He was bold, but he never forgot who he was. We see this again in verse 30, verse 31, and verse 32. He will tell God again and again, God, don't be angry with me. Lord, don't be angry with me. So he never forgot his place or who it is that he was talking to. He still maintains a right posture or reverence before God. I find that many of us, when we are told that God is our friend, we begin to imagine that me and God, we are my boys. Some of my prayers I've had in Skiza tunes, and I was like, wow. Remember, you and God are not my boys. Now, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, you may approach my throne of grace boldly and confidently, that you might receive mercy for your sins, and find grace to help you in your time of need. So yes, you can approach boldly and confidently, but it never says you can approach irreverently. And Abraham knows the difference. And so he'll be like, God, I am Please forgive me. Don't be angry with me. But then he would be still shamelessly audacious and bold in his requests. May you understand the difference between boldness and irreverence. And may we be boldly reverent and declare as we approach God in our prayers. Amen. Here's the fourth thing. I didn't know how to write this. I said repeat. Okay? What I meant is pray without ceasing. Okay, so I was like, okay, I'm looking for arts, so forgive me. But repeat. And what I see in Abraham is that he did not just give one request and then he was gone. No, but he comes back again and again and again. In fact, I counted 6 times the very same thing. He comes back again and again to the Lord. In fact, so much so that he feared he was exhausting God. Remember that? He was so apologetic. But God is never exhausted with our prayers. Oh, thanks be to God. In fact, I believe that our problem is not that we pray too much. Our problem is that we never pray enough. That's our problem. God is never exhausted in our prayers. Not once in this story do you hear God saying to Abraham, "Where Abraham, Tosheka." God is actually willing to hear the man again and again and again as he comes over the same story, right? In fact, you and I wonder, why did Abraham have to stop at the 6th time? There was no indication from the Lord that the Lord was tired. Maybe he could have gone all the way. This is what the Lord Jesus Christ said to his disciples in Luke chapter 18, verse 1. He said, "Pray and never give up." And he gave them the example of the persistent widow. Friends, you can never exhaust God. God loves to hear you pray. Go to him again and again. Pray without ceasing. That's what 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17 says. Pray without ceasing. Pray with all kinds of prayers and on all occasions. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. Devote yourself to prayer. Colossians chapter 4. Pray again and again. But leave the answer to him. I'm not here teaching that we twist the arm of God, but that we have a duty to pray again and again. Here's the last one. Righteousness. Okay, I know that's a bit odd. Righteousness. Did you see the importance of righteousness in this story? Were you keen to see just the place of righteousness? From the very beginning, when God is talking about Abraham and his family, he says, you know, "I have called him that he may teach his children righteousness and justice." And then this one spoke to me so much. The fate of Sodom was decided by the number of the righteous, not by the number of the wicked. In fact, the number of the wicked is irrelevant. And I don't know how many they were. The hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands, it was irrelevant. The fate of Sodom was decided by the number of the righteous. And God will come down to 10. And he says, "If I find 10 righteous people, I will spare Sodom." I was like, "God, seriously, spare? Do you know how wicked these people are? How messed up they are? The kind of things that, the atrocities they are committing, you will forgive them because of 10 righteous people?" Friends, yes, your righteousness matters. Your righteousness is a big thing before God. You never know what service you are rendering to our nation with your righteousness. Maybe somebody needs to hear this. You never know what service you are rendering to this nation because you're righteous. This is what Proverbs chapter 14, verse 34 says. It says, "Righteousness exalts a nation." Now, I know that some of you, perhaps, you have been leading a righteous life and you feel like you have nothing to show for it. You know, at your places of work, people are wicked. You know, people are corrupt. People are sleeping around and they are advancing in their careers. You know, and here you are, you have held on to your own integrity and you wonder, what good has come to me, you know, having held on to my own integrity when the wicked are prospering? And so you feel like, you know this phrase for, if you can't beat them, join them, and you are tempted. Friends, do not do it. It is possible maybe you have not won anyone to the Lord with your righteousness, but how do you know you have not won the Lord over to the people? Because you're righteous. You can also win the Lord over to the people because you have maintained your integrity. And that's why I'm saying some of you, maybe the service you're rendering to this country is with your righteousness. The Lord looks at us and is like, I will not destroy that nation because of so-and-so, 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 who is there? Maybe you are the 10th person. And here you are wanting to give up like Elijah. Give up. I'm the only one who is righteous. Maybe you are the only one who is righteous, but maybe you are the only one that we need. Your righteousness matters. Somebody put it like this. He said, make your life a prayer, even as you make prayer your life. Can I repeat that? He said, make your life a prayer. You know, that sweet fragrance, that aroma that comes out of a life well lived, a righteous life. He says, make your life a prayer, even as you make prayer your life. Maybe somebody needs to hear that. Don't give up. Righteousness is key. And it can move the hand of God to act in certain ways. Amen? I want to repeat those five things that we have mentioned about Abraham and prayer. The first thing we have said is what? That he remained alone with God. And we're saying, find time to be alone with God. Second thing is what? Reflect on the Lord's word. Indeed, begin to understand the character of God, because these are the things that you tell him in prayer. What's the third thing? Your reverence. Be bold, but don't lose your reverence before God. What's the fourth thing? Repeat again. Pray without ceasing. And the last thing? Righteousness. I want to end with Christ and say this, that Jesus Christ is really the better Abraham. He did what Abraham could not do. You know, Abraham, in as much as he really prayed and interceded for Sodom, the Sodomites were still destroyed because God found no one righteous there, not even one. Okay, I know you guys are saying, you know, there was Lot, you know, and his family. And yes, the Lord did rescue them, but as to their righteousness, it's debatable if you read the story as it continues. But this is what the Lord Jesus Christ did. He took our punishment, the thing that Abraham was never able to do for Sodom. Jesus Christ said, I will take their place. And the wrath of God came upon him. In fact, the Bible talks about the gospel like this. It says it was that divine exchange where God took him who was without sin and he made him sin for us so that in him we might become the what? The righteousness of God. Us, who the Bible says no one is righteous, no, not one. Now we become the righteousness of God. Jesus did what Abraham could not do on that cross. It's called the finished work. And there is something else that did better than Abraham. It's called the continuing work of Christ, which is this, that he ever lives to make intercession for us. Jesus Christ is in heaven interceding for you and I without ceasing. When Abraham was praying, he prayed 6 times. And after the 6th time, he was like, you know, I'm done. But Jesus ever lives to make intercession. In fact, this is what Job says. You know, I'm currently reading the book of Job. You know, Job has a lot to say about his Redeemer. He says this in chapter 16, verse 19 to 21. He says, even now my witness is in heaven. My advocate is on high. My intercessor is my friend. On behalf of man, he pleads with God as one pleads for a friend. And I'm like, yes, that's my Jesus. And I wonder, do you know this Jesus? This is the greater Abraham who prays for us, who makes intercession for us, who moves the hand of God to our favor. Do you know him? I want to speak to those of you who maybe are living as enemies of the Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, you are changing yourself because the Lord Jesus Christ is for you and not against you. And I'm praying in 2024 that you will get to know him. that you will come under his cover. Because he is for you. As for the rest of us believers, I want us to see just what a privilege and an honor it is to join Jesus in his profession. This is the work, the great work, the continuing work of Christ, the ministry of interceding for people. We have the privilege of joining him in that work. Jesus is not dying every day, but he's interceding every day, and we can do that too. And so I want to challenge you this week, if you can, and I'm hoping that you all will, please join us in that time of prayer and fasting. Why? Because we say that prayer matters. Prayer is powerful. Prayer is moving the hand of God to act in ways that if you and I understood, how we would make this our lives. So don't miss out on this. And I'm praying that 2024, your 2024 will be marked with lots of prayer. Amen? Let us pray. Dear God, we want to thank you because you have given us such a great privilege and a great honor. I marvel, Lord, that we do not understand it. Just the height, the depth, the length, the width of this thing called prayer. I know that we have an enemy who has tried to eclipse it from us so that we do not understand what it's all about. It has become our biggest struggle that we do not engage in prayer, in communing with you. And yet from today's word, we have learned that the power really is in the prayer. I thank you, Holy Spirit of God, that you intercede for us even with wordless groans because we do not know how to pray. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you live to make intercession for us. Oh, how I ask, my God, that you would help us to join you in this great work. Let it not be said of us like it was in the book of Ezekiel that you're looking to see somebody standing in the gap and you did not find any. And so you sent your judgments. I pray, Lord, that when you look at us, you look at our country, you will find Mamlakites in prayer. You will find Mamlakites standing in the gap. You will find a community of people given to prayer, who understand the power of prayer, who are much in your presence, communing with you, interceding, petitioning, offering thanksgiving. And may our prayers, Lord, rise up to you as a sweet aroma and fragrance, and may they be acceptable to you. And may you be pleased, Lord, to hear and to hearken to the prayers of these people. God, we have seen also the importance of righteousness. I pray, Lord, that as we live our lives, that our praying will not just be with words, but that we will also pray with our actions, how we live, that will also be pleasing to you. So help us, Lord, in our weakness. Remember those also in our midst who haven't submitted themselves to Christ. And I pray that as long as it's called today, that they will not harden their hearts, that they will understand that you, our God, in your patience, are really for them and not against them. May you be pleased to add to our numbers those who have become believers. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.